Behind home plate, we bringing it to them all day. All day. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Birdland. Win or lose, we bringing it to you always. Always. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Orange or black, we rebuild the pack. No matter where we at, you know we coming back. Section 336, we on this, so tune in. Tune in. You know what's up? Welcome to Birdland. Yeah. Welcome to Birdland. You know what's up, son. Welcome to Birdland. Birdland.
Now, here come the boys from Section 336.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Baltimore sports fans of all ages, welcome to Section 336, Next Generation Baltimore Sports Talk. I am your Daily Center host, Matt Soroka. As always, I'm joined by the button lover, a guy who maybe now has no team to root for since his team has been knocked out of the playoffs.
Who's my team?
Josh Soroka.
Who's my team?
Don't lie. We saw you wearing the Joe Flacco jersey while watching the Browns game.
Well, yeah, I was watching the Browns game. I mean, I wore a Ravens jersey to watch the Browns game. I think that's as close as I can get to a weekend where there's no Ravens football.
Okay. Well, your boy got crushed.
I know. Poor Joe. Poor Joe. He was... Before that game, he was the comeback story of the year. Fun guy to root for. But if we really want to dig into Wild Card Weekend, I believe your text might, or did I just lose you?
What was my text?
You were cheering for the Steelers. No.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I hope all Baltimore sports fans were, because you'd rather play the Steelers.
Yeah. I don't want to play the Bills.
Well, what about the Texans? Would you rather play the Texans or the Steelers? I was just looking at one round.
I wanted two rounds. Yeah, I wanted to play the Dolphins. I mean, I don't. Yeah, or I'm glad I'm glad that Kansas City and Boston play each other, so we don't have to play both of them.
Okay, you said Kansas City and Boston. I'm just gonna let it go though.
I said Boston.
Yeah, yeah. We know what you mean.
Tracked and got the towns wrong.
Yeah. No, the setup against the Houston Texans is interesting, because I was a little surprised. We're nine. Last time I checked, we're 9-point favorites, which sounds about right on the one hand, because we've dominated the league. We've been dominating lately. On the other hand, the Texans look really good against the Browns. I think anyone who bet the Browns last week, from the moment the game started, they were like, oh crap, we should have remembered this is the Browns.
Yep.
And the Texans, I made that mistake. And I think everyone felt like that. Yeah. And the Texans, I think, were just a better team all around. But I think people thought, because CJ Stroud was a rookie, that when he got in the playoffs, so he would forget how to play quarterback.
You mean like Lamar Jackson has?
Yeah. But he didn't forget how to play quarterback. He played really well. Right. And I was surprised that the Cleveland defense couldn't do anything to him. But this is going to be a different test. So the Texans are coming in hot. CJ Stroud is playing well. But, you know, they're going to go away from the dome. They're going to go out in these fridges. Supposed to be cold on Saturday and play against a Ravens team playing really good. Oh, and by the way, Mark Andrews is back to practice. So I'm pumped for Saturday.
What does that mean for Sunday or Saturday if Mark Andrews is back at practice? He's going to try to go, right?
I assume. Yeah, he was full participant. So he wasn't even like part. He was like full participant. Right. So I assume he's good to go.
All right. I expect then some two tight end packages out there.
Yeah. I don't take CJ Stroud lightly. I think the dude's a stud. I think they have some good playmakers. But obviously the Ravens have been the best team down the stretch here. And so I expect that to continue.
But I'm
excited for the game.
No, it is. It's exciting. And it's the Ravens are doing what the Ravens are holding up their end of the bargain to keep us entertained all the way up to spring training.
Yeah.
It's a tougher ask, because it means we're asking for all the way to the Super Bowl. But yeah, they're getting us up there.
It's been a bummer kind of 2 weeks, because the last 2 weeks the Ravens haven't. I mean, there was the, if you want to call it a game.
Steelers game doesn't count.
Yeah, it doesn't. It's like a preseason game. And then. And then last week they didn't play. So I'm like, I'm itching for some Ravens football, because they're so fun to watch right now. So I'm pumped for Saturday.
Yeah. I think I'm going to get a hold of Dad and go watch it with him.
And, yeah. All right. I think I'll come down for the Super Bowl.
Super Bowl, that'd be good. We all get together somewhere for the Super Bowl.
Yeah,
I'm down.
Right.
So, and then after that, we'll see each other for spring training. You want to transition to some baseball?
Yeah, there's been actual Orioles news to talk about. Orioles are making moves happen.
Let's stretch it as far as news. You're stretching it a little bit.
You think so?
Talk about. I don't know if I would classify it as news.
All right. I mean, the three big things that, at least to me, and maybe I'm missing something, is we signed 19 international picks. We went to arbitration, solved most of the arbitration cases. We still have a couple more pending we can get into. And then the other news is we opened up the facility in the DR, and that was the big kind of who-to event. So who's who event. So I think those are especially the two kind of bookends are exciting developments about the signings, the prospects, and relatedly about this new DR facility. I mean, I think that's exciting, good news for the Orioles. But maybe you don't think so, Josh? Oh, did Josh just leave me? Josh just dropped me out on here. All right. Well, I'll do the show solo he thought it was light news. I thought that was pretty significant news, those three things. And so maybe Josh is like, these are so not important, and I don't even want to talk about them. I want to get to the 19 guys we signed. Before that, I want to talk about this DR facility, Dominican Republic, and I want to see if Josh, how many names Josh knows from this star-studded list who came to the unveiling, and see if Josh is paying attention. What was it? Bautista, Hanser Alberto.
Has it ever happened where I've dropped off the call? I think it's always your internet that drops off, but my Chrome completely locked up and then just crashed.
Well,
mid conversation. So we'll see.
Okay. Well, this is good, because you're right. It's usually me. So now I feel better.
Yeah.
Whenever it happens to me the next 10 times, I'll remember it's the one time happened to you.
I was going to say it's the first time and hopefully only time. So you were going through some of the arbitrations.
Yeah. Like Hanser Alberto and Vladimir Guerrero.
These are old guys, not current arbitration issues.
And Felix Bautista and Melvin Mora. You know what all these guys have in common?
They all are from the Dominican.
I might be making up Melvin Mora. I don't know. Is that true, Melvin Mora? These are all guys who, yes. And these are all guys who Baldo Jimenez. Yeah, Melvin Mora. Who else?
Now, Baldo Jimenez was at the opening.
That's what I'm talking about. All these guys, and Felix Bautista was there. All these guys were at the opening ceremony.
Yeah.
All the guys I'm naming. So, the Orioles brought a bunch of guys back, which I thought kind of was, I didn't see a lot of people talking about it, but I thought that was pretty cool.
It was awesome. It was cool to see those guys. It's cool to see the Orioles invest in, they made this announcement last year, I believe, is when they announced that they would be building this. So they built it pretty fast, quick turnaround.
I thought it was 2 years ago, but yeah.
It was 2 years. I mean, I'm guessing you don't have as many building inspectors and everyone down in the Dominican, but who knows? Either way, it looks like an awesome facility, and it's cool to see this. It's crazy because those Dominican kids, we draft them at the age of like 16. And then they go to this academy, and it's basically their school where they teach them baseball and English and get them ready for the majors.
Right. So it's a little, and there's cafeteria, like a little college campus.
Yeah.
It's kind of deal. Yeah.
It's really a neat thing. I'm sure there's probably some private institutes in the States like that for, like, if you really want to dedicate your life to baseball.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's cool. It's a neat way to be kind of set up in the Dominican. So it's exciting.
Yeah. And I mean, there's a reason that, I mean, the DR, I don't know what the population is, but the proportion of MLB players, right, that come out of such a small country is kind of wild. But it's because a lot of them kind of eat, sleep, and breathe baseball. But I just thought it was cool from tapping in to both Orioles history and our connection with the Dominican Republic going back to older players, but also, I mean, our most recent guys, Felix Bautista, came out of the Dominican Republic.
Yeah.
And so it was cool to connect kind of the current with the history. And that was just, I thought that was fun. I thought it was fun to see Obando Jimenez wearing his Orioles cap. I thought it was cool. I didn't get mad.
Nope. When it's old guys like that, you can't get mad. It's like, it wasn't his fault that he came in and blew that game.
Yeah. I agree. And so I thought it was cool for Michael Elias, not just to build the facility, but I thought he did the opening ceremony right. And kind of at that same, I mean, that happened, I don't know, just right a couple of days ago. And just yesterday we signed
19
right? players, not all from the DR, but some of them were from the DR.
Yeah, 19 kids.
Yeah, the majority of which were from the DR. I have a list up now. And actually, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are from Venezuela.
Right. I assume they're going to send all of them to the Dominican Academy.
I don't know how that works. And then the rest, outside the people from Venezuela, the rest are from the Dominican. And I don't know, Josh, because then there's also that league in Florida where they play at. But I think you graduate...
The Gulf Coast League? What league in Florida?
You know, there's the league in Florida where all the 17 and 18-year-olds play.
I'm
making this up.
I thought that was
the Verge people on here.
I thought that was just like Florida Complex, like where they would bring them to work out.
Yeah, it's like a complex. But then there's other teams, like Boston and the Yankees.
It's just the year-round baseball workouts there.
Stuff. Right, but there's like an official. They have games and they keep track.
Yes, they do.
And stuff. Yeah, and so I don't know at what point you go from. I mean I don't know if it's a couple of 18 or 19. Like I don't know what point.
I think it's like right. Yeah, like right before A ball. Like I feel
right
like,
before A ball.
You know, you sign Jackson Holliday, you send him there immediately because you want him to get like a season in there because he's drafted near the end of minor league ball and stuff. So.
Or yeah, he might have went right to A ball, but yeah. So anyway, it's I'm not gonna. I mean, I know people are making assumptions just based on the dollar amount, and there was. I think we got two guys in top 40, which was encouraging. But I'm even the two guys top 40 means nothing. I remember a few years ago, like what was his name, Victor Mesa or something, was the big guy that we were wanting to get. The Marlins got him. I've never heard his name again. I'm not giving my hopes up or excited about any of these signings. I think it's good. Continue to do it. Continue. I mean, this is kind of the hard work. You throw out 100 seeds and you hope one or two of them bloom.
And baseball's a numbers game. Exactly. You sign 19 of these guys hoping that one of them makes it onto your roster.
Yeah, hoping you get one Felix Bautista out of them.
Correct.
Yeah. So I agree. It's good news. It's something that philosophically we didn't participate for a while in. And so now we're the opposite. We have a top line facility. We're having really good signings every year now, and they're just going to get better. One would presume now with this facility, we seem to kind of develop these connections, which I think is really important. I think it's cool to see Felix Bautista down there and these other players, not just in terms of kind of honoring the Orioles, but kind of helps with the recruitment. I'm sure.
Yeah.
These younger players. So yeah, and that will just continue. So that's good. So I guess the Dodgers can have all of Japan, and we'll focus on the DR.
That's fine. It's a little cheaper. I understand.
Yeah, that's true.
So the Orioles also this week released their movie 101.
Oh, so much news! I didn't even mention that in all my news.
No, there's
the arbitration that they
also talk about
the movie. Top prospects, first team ever to have Baseball America top three overall prospect in the world three straight years.
Can I ask you something?
Yes.
That's really cool and says really strong things about our drafting to have Adley, then Gunner, then Jackson.
Very cool.
But it also kind of says where we were, that we were able to take number one picks overall for three straight years. Right, like, isn't there a little bit of like? Well, I guess Gunner wasn't a number one pick.
No,
so I guess it cares more about draft. I'm just saying
supplemental pick.
you don't see teams that are great all the time having top farm systems.
And when Jackson Holliday was taken number one, not everyone agreed that he was the number one overall pick to go to.
All right, good. So this speaks highly of Mike Elias and the way we draft.
I think it does.
And I think even better, it speaks about how we develop players. Because we're getting Jackson Holliday. I mean,
and Josh, prior to Mike Elias, we would get top picks in the draft. Sometimes even number one.
Right. Yeah, you're right.
And they almost never worked out. But yeah, I get your point. Like, we have a better shot at this than the Dodgers and Braves do. Like, I get that.
Yeah, and the fact that Adley is turned out, Gunnar turned out, and now everyone's just assuming Jackson Holliday is going to be a star this year is huge. And I keep staring at Jackson Holliday, and I can't believe that this kid is going to be playing for the Orioles this year and is a year older than my daughter, a year older than Emma. It's crazy that this kid is going to be up there. And I can't wait to cheer him on.
Yeah, I saw, probably shouldn't have mentioned this. I just saw right on X right before I logged on. Sunglass guy. We like him, but he had a tweet saying, you know, that about tempering his expectations, which I get, that Jackson Holliday could hit 520 with 20 home runs in spring training and won't be called up until the end of May because that's how the Orioles run things.
No, Jackson Holliday's going to be on this team opening day.
If he settle plays down, well, he's going to be.
Just Adley got hurt. His plan was opening
that's
day.
Right.
Hurt.
Gunnar was up here before anyone expected Gunnar to be here.
Yep.
Heston Kerstad moved fast. If it wasn't for the myocarditis, he would have moved fast through the system too. Right. They're not slow playing these positional hitters.
No.
They're not. And if especially these the lower ranked prospects, the Connor Norby. Like maybe you can, but that's just because lack of room. Top prospects, watch what they're doing in the minors. They're not letting them play a whole year in any level. They're moving them up. Jackson Holliday, he ended the year at AAA. He moved up three levels. What are you talking about? What are you implying that our management is slowing these guys down? That's not true. We're fast tracking them.
Right. The only slight argument you could give to slow tracking a player was Grayson Rodriguez.
Yes.
But we don't know if that was the case or if there was still something we wanted to see from him because he also took more refinement after he came up.
Yeah.
To get to the love now.
Right. And I will argue to my grave that he was going to be caught up
before he got hurt.
Right after he got that next start.
Oh, I totally agree.
Was
going
to be the call up. His last start in AAA was when he got hurt. I'm convinced of that. And then it made it look really bad because that extended his time in AAA.
Correct.
Right, until the next year. So
right. It wasn't supposed to be that way.
Right.
So I totally agree with that.
Yeah. But specifically with the hitters and position players, like pay attention to what's in the mind. Listen to On the Verge some more because they're moving these guys fast through the system. All right.
Yes.
So that's cool. All right. Yeah. So
the movie. Did you watch the movie?
I did.
Which I hate the name 101. I get it's based on the number of wins.
We won 101 games.
Right. But there's a lot of popular movies that start with the title 101.
Yeah.
And I don't like the name because I cannot say 101 without the theme song to 101 Dalmatian Street getting stuck in my head.
Okay, that doesn't happen to me.
It will one day.
Okay. You know, I knew this would happen, listeners, and I apologize. This is a cool video that the Orioles made recapping the season.
Yeah.
And I knew Josh couldn't get a sentence out without putting on his critical little glasses and judging the Orioles. And his title, I just knew this was coming, listeners. I'm sorry. I'm sorry he takes these moments. And he just becomes this overly critical. And I feel like when I watched this and I watched it with my son, Silas, and we sat there on the bed and watched it on our computer because I couldn't pull it up on the TV because it's on that stupid website. And so we watched it on the computer.
I kept my mouth shut about that because I waited until it hit YouTube so then I could pull it on other things.
Oh, you can watch on YouTube now?
Yeah, now you can search for it on YouTube.
You know what made me mad? Now I'm going to be with you, super critical. How come I could, the first thing I did is I tried to pull it up on the MLB app. And I thought, they have videos on the MLB app. Yep. Why is it not a video on there?
I did the same exact thing. I tried that and it didn't work. So then today I finally got around to watching it on YouTube.
Orioles.com, and it doesn't work great on the big TV.
No, it doesn't. But yeah, it's on YouTube, so you can search for it on the YouTube app on your TV and find it.
Okay. Son's watch it twice. When he goes to watch it the third time, he'll go there and watch it.
But that's the only critical thing you'll hear me say about it, because it's a great video. It's great memories. Sure, there's always things I would have done differently, but it's a great video. It's great memories. It reminds me of the Why Not video that is our childhood that we will cherish. It reminds me of the Buckle Up Birds after 14 years of losing. It's a cool video. I liked the interviews with Jeff Arnold and Kevin Brown, as well as Michael Eisen and the players. But I liked, and Ben McDonald, I liked hearing these guys talk about.
You didn't mention Brett Hollander.
And Brett Hollander, of course.
Okay.
All those. I enjoyed the video. I did enjoy the movie. I enjoyed the movie.
Why was there no Jim Palmer?
There was Jim Palmer.
Only clips of him, like, in the booth talking. There was no.
Yes, he did not sit down for a separate interview.
Right.
So.
You okay with that?
I'm fine with that.
Okay.
I thought it was very well. I thought it was very good. I enjoyed it. It's a fun season to look back on. The problem is, it reminds me of the 89 video. It reminds me of the Buckle Up Birds video. And the problem with all three of these videos is the season ended too early.
Well, it wasn't. Well, that when we got done watching it, my son said two things. The first thing my son said was, well, how come they didn't show the playoffs? I said, well, son, they like movies with happy endings.
And, yeah, correct.
And then he said, can we watch it again? So he liked it. It's interesting you're making those comparisons. I thought this video felt more like a documentary and lacked a little bit maybe of the funness.
Yes, that would be my...
Maybe the other videos, especially the Why Not video, had.
Agreed. That's my critique, is I felt like when they showed mic'd up stuff, when they showed conversations about the bird bath, when they showed Homer Hoes stuff, it's all stuff I've seen before. Where there wasn't a behind the scenes type look at this stuff. It was more of a documentary style, like, hey, let's sit back and remember this year, which is good.
Yeah.
But you're right. It's a documentary.
Yeah. A couple of things just about the season that kind of I was reminded of as watching the 101. And that's, first of all, you think about this team, right? You think about the stars on this team, like Adley Rutschman, like Gunnar Henderson, like Santander, kind of the foundation of this team. But like the players that are highlighted repeatedly are the players at the beginning of the season that no one would have expected to be part of the team.
It was
right.
Like, they highlighted Adam Frazier double.
Yeah, like even before that, the beginning, like when they did like these focus on one player, it was like Ryan O'Hearn.
Yes,
and then it was like Cano, and then it was like Aaron Hicks. Right.
Yeah. No.
It
exactly.
Was all it was... these role players that we forget had such a significant contribution to this team that we did not account for. Having this conversation at the same time last year, not once in our podcast did we mention the names O'Hearn or Cano or Hicks.
And even like Hicks, when they signed Hicks, we're like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
And here Eliza's like, hey, Mullins went down. I knew Hicks was available. I grabbed him. And looking back, it's like, yeah, Hicks was the perfect fit for that. And Hicks did get us through that. And then you got Elias sitting there and saying, I don't know if we would have gotten where we were without Hicks on this team. And that's cool stuff.
Yeah. So, yeah. So overall, I really liked it. It also was kind of cool to see no fans in the stands at the beginning of the season. And then throughout the video, there's like more and more fans.
Fills up. Yeah.
So there was some cool moments. I thought sometimes they could have like that Frazier double to me is just such a big moment. And it was like, I remember the at bat, it was like 1-2. And I think it was against Fairbanks, who was like throwing 102 miles per hour.
Yeah.
And I think they could have like done a better job of setting the context of some of the at bats.
Oh, or like,
but yeah, just like setting the scene a little bit more.
Yes, I agree.
But that's a minor thing.
I did like a little slight behind the scenes about how when they clinched playoffs, how they weren't going to have much of a celebration. We're just going to have a nice celebration. But it was such a big win that it just turned into this huge celebration.
Yeah.
So I like that. I enjoyed that part.
No, I agree. Right.
They could have set up the big Santander home run, the Ryan O'Hearn home run, the double. They could have set all this stuff up a little better.
Yeah.
DL Hall coming back.
That's another kind of big story I thought was cool that they kind of missed out on a little bit.
Yeah.
His journey. Yeah.
But who was it? Well, it was Ben McDonald, right? Telling the story about DL Hall.
Yeah.
And he came in and said,
It
was Grayson Rodriguez coming in to face the Dodgers.
I guess it's the Dodgers, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was cool to see Ben McDonald be like, oh, this guy's fired up.
Yeah.
And of course, he came in and dominated.
Yeah. Which kind of was the start of his run at the end of the season.
But yeah, it's nice. Man, it got me excited for baseball season. I love that when baseball season gets here, it's every single day there's something exciting.
Yeah. Like
we talk about how with Ravens, we had 2 weeks of real nothing. And for baseball, you get maybe a day of that. Maybe you get a Thursday off. Maybe a Monday off.
Yeah, and just the amount of just unexpected heroes. And yeah, it made you just be romantic about baseball to see all these great moments. And it was fun to watch it. Casas and I were talking, and like, you remember these big moments in the season.
Yeah.
Good and bad. Like, you remember the Felix Bautista injury. We also remember that big series in Tampa Bay where we went to Tampa and saw that. And so like, Sas and I were like talking like, well, when are they going to show this moment? And kind of trying to predict when they're going to show that moment.
That's cool.
Well, when will they show the Sunday night, you know, the seven runs, which I thought they could have played that up more too, by the way.
Right. Yes, but
that big seven run night.
Blowout. Yeah.
And so it's kind of cool having these. And then there were some things that I'd forgotten that even happened. Like, who was the first injury, early on that they showed?
Cedric?
Wasn't there injury before Cedric? I remember the Cedric, and I was like, oh, I forgot he was out for a little while. Now I'm blank on who got hurt for a little bit. But anyway, even now. But yeah, I thought it was cool both to remember things I'd forgotten, but also to kind of anticipate these cool moments that you knew were coming. So yeah, I thought it was cool. And they should do it every year.
No, totally every year, as long as the seasons are fun. I had this idea where, because you're right, because they were bringing up, oh, Aaron Hicks made this huge play, Ryan O'Hearn made this huge moment, Austin Hayes, who was healthy all season, I think, became this big star. I want to do this season on Section 336. We got to figure out what we call it or whatever, but I want to do like the hero of the week or something, where, you know, we give that player just praise for a week and he's the guy for that week. And we can kind of keep score. And then at the end of the season, we can be like, man, look at this. Gunnar Henderson was our star player, star of the week for 10 weeks, and do something cool like that, because I want to remember all of this, especially when we're going in. We went in with no expectations last year. We went in, you and I had high expectations.
Yeah, I mean, we played decent the year before, so there was hopes that we could build off that.
But still, national media said we'd be in last place.
And they did a great job of, I think, feeding in the national media sound bites. I was waiting for a Section 336 sound bite. Didn't hear that one.
I was also looking for some Birdman Sports t-shirts and couldn't see any of that.
Oh, you were looking for those? Yeah. Yeah, I thought they could add more shots to the crowd. I was like, show me some more Tampa Bay crowd. But
I totally agree with all that. I lost my train of thought, but
No, you were talking about recognizing someone each week.
Yeah, I want to recognize someone each week as like the star, the guy for that week. So then we have like at the end of the season, we can look back and remember. how did this guy get this many stars or whatever, you know, our gold stars or coconuts, whatever we want to hand out, but a little award each week of that, of the guy that week.
Yeah.
So,
no, it's a good point because like we said, there was these guys on this roster who at the, when we were having the same conversation in January last year, we would have never even foreseen that they not only would even make the team, let alone have a significant say. And you would think that becomes harder and harder every year because our roster is more solidified every single year. So is there even room for that? But
there happens. Is. That's what's special with baseball. And we always like we wrap it up at the end of the year with the OVP. All right, Gunnar Henderson was the OVP this year. But we need to do something weekly so that we can recognize Ryan O'Hearn, Aaron Hicks, Jorge Mateo, these guys who don't come off your lips as the star of the year, but made a key impact to get you those 101 wins or whatever it is this upcoming season as we roll in like with huge expectations on this team.
They also didn't show the Ryan McKenna dropping that first.
Yes, they didn't. They did not talk about that.
In the second game of the season, dropping that ball, and we would have.
That would be that would be made by a that would be something maybe you would see if like ESPN did a 30 for 30 or something. Not when it's made by the Orioles about the Orioles. You're not going to see the negative. That's it's why the playoffs they avoided.
Yeah. I'm also curious to see if they do this again. I'm curious to see how our players' personalities develop because I feel like right now, I don't want to say our players without personality. I think Adley Rutschman did a lot of fun stuff last year. They did some dress up. I remember going to New York and working at the MLB store and he was funny there.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it seems like there were some good personalities in the bullpen. But a lot of these young players, understandably, are there trying to make a name for themselves. So maybe are less outspoken or less, you know, maybe comfortable with their kind of unique personalities. I mean, or maybe they're all just quiet, hardworking kids. And so they don't.
Yeah,
that's not a side of them. But
well, it's also they all came up. They've all been focused on getting to this point and they're not used to the cameras and everything around them yet, probably.
Yeah, but I think they could play that angle up some more. Like I know like they have the Star Wars thing they're into or a Lego Star Wars thing.
Yeah. Yeah,
I think you play that up some more with the Legos and stuff, and I'm sure there's some other locker room stuff that's shenanigans happening that you could
right. And we saw, and we did see some of that with the Homer Hose, with some mic'd up segments with the
bullpen,
in the bullpen. So
yeah, all right. Yeah, so it was good. It was good. Well done, Orioles. Nice job, production staff.
Yeah. The Orioles, speaking of production staff, they also announced their promotions this week.
Ooh.
For this upcoming season.
Ooh, I know you love that.
Well, did you see how they announced the promotions? Because I want to talk about this before we get to the promotions.
I saw on X, I got to be honest, I'm a bad Orioles fan. I saw on X, there was a video. I never even clicked on it.
All right, I clicked on the
link for the promotions. I didn't watch the 30-second video. I'm sorry.
The video was Mr. Splash making the announcement. Like it was like someone stole Mr. Splash's Homer Hose.
Okay.
But then he was using that to announce this thing.
Okay.
And my question for you is Mr. Splash, the bird bath, the Homer Hose, all that.
Right.
So that was something really magical last year. Because it kind of just came up naturally with the players, and the players created this. The Orioles have now taken it with the marketing side, and they're just rolling with it, and they're already doing it. It's the plan. I mean, they've got Mr. Splash making this video announcement. They got Mr. Splash out at the Orioles caravans to get your photo taken with Mr. Splash. They're doing a Mr. Splash giveaway bobblehead.
May 10th, get your tickets. First 25,000 fans.
Mr. Splash is now a mascot of the Orioles.
Yeah.
Does that take something away from the naturalness of it last year?
I'm curious to see. I assume they're not coming back with the Homer Hose and stuff.
I think it's all coming back.
No, the Homer Hose isn't coming back.
The Bird Bath is.
Yeah, but the Bird Bath is different. You're the Orioles. You know, you're the birds.
Yeah, but I get that. But the whole point of the Bird Bath was to kind of spin off the Homer Hose.
No, the Homer Hose was about being in your backyard playing wiffle ball.
And drinking out of the garden hose.
Yeah, you're not drinking out of the Bird Bath.
I know, but the spraying of the Bird Bath was to get the whole idea was Cole Irvin and...
You can do the sprinkler.
Oh, to do the sprinkler, splashed. And they get splashed and sprinkled out there to be part of it. Yeah. So, I don't know. I like... Now, I'll tell you, on Birdland Sports, I retired all the Bird Bath stuff from last year. Because I was like, that's last year's stuff. We're going to have something cool this year. And then I made some new Bird Bath shirts this week and Homer Hose shirts this week because it's coming back. And it's very clear through the promotions that the Bird Bath Splash Zone is back for all home games.
Yeah, I don't really care. And I mean, we'll see if the Homer Hose stuff is back. I don't really care that much. But I mean,
My problem is it's a gimmick that was really fun and special for the players. And now it's been taken over by marketing and promotions. So it's not a player-driven thing anymore.
What could have been done, Josh? What could have been done? We should not do it anymore because it was a player's idea?
No, I think you back off and you see what the players naturally do and you lean into that. But I guess... I don't know what else. I guess it's the same way as last year. The Orioles were not doing the home run chain, but you could still go in the store and buy a home run chain. I guess it's the same thing. All right, let's let this go on.
And I'm sure it helped ticket sales in that section.
I'm sure it did. And you know what? If it's a Sunday afternoon, a Saturday afternoon, I want to be in that Bird Bath area because it is hot in Camden Yards in the summer out there.
I don't want to be there. I'm afraid I'll be stuck next to someone with a huge floaty. I can't even sit down because their floaties all bumping into me.
Yeah, that's an issue.
A bunch of crazies out there.
But promotion schedules out. Some cool things. You know I love the bobbleheads. And I believe it is 5 bobbleheads this year.
Yeah. Have you marked your calendar? Are you going to make any trips for these bobbleheads? Are you just going to go on X and say, oh, guys, I need this bobblehead. Someone please give me this bobblehead.
Hey, every bobblehead I got last year, I think maybe one a listener sent me. The rest I have paid people for.
All right.
I will either go on eBay or go on Facebook or Twitter and find someone to mail me these bobbleheads. So we've got April 27th, Brandon Hyde. May 10th, Mr. Splash. Anthony Santander, June 1st.
Oh, assuming he's not traded. Okay.
And that's right. Well, yeah, that'll be before the trade deadline. And it's a walk-off bobblehead of him dropping the bat, which is cool. And then there is a Adley Rutschman switch hitter bobblehead that they haven't showed the design yet. So I don't know how you celebrate Adley being a switch hitter. I'm not sure how you do that as a bobblehead.
Yeah, that'd be interesting.
And then there is Gunnar Henderson AL Rookie of the Year bobblehead. So those two, they haven't showed designs of yet. But 5 bobbleheads. I'm a huge bobblehead guy, so I'm excited about that. They are also bringing back the Hawaiian shirt and the bucket hat.
I thought the bucket hat kind of looked fire with the black B on the one side and the City Connect and all the splashy colors on the other side. I kind of looked like that. That's the first floppy hat they were ever given away that I thought, oh, that's kind of cool.
And I think the City Connect Hawaiian shirt is pretty cool too.
Yeah, no, I like the Hawaiian shirt too. There's a big push with these things. I mean, there's a lot of City Connect stuff.
There's a lot of City Connect stuff. I figure it's the Orioles have a new logo they get to push out, so they get to do new things with it. But I like that. I think they're doing. There's a soccer jersey. There's a beach towel. There is a 90s. Throwback like Oriole hat, and there is an old t-shirt, like 70s Oriole font t-shirt. So some cool giveaways. I think the promotion team did a really good job this year with what they've announced so far.
You didn't mention the hot dog ketchup and mustard and relish t-shirt.
Yeah, because they did that a few years ago and they're just bringing it back. It looks like the exact same shirt. So that's a fail. That's a fail to me.
They need more people wearing their shirts, so in the hot dog race they can show people in Jumbotron.
Right. Like that's why I didn't say, oh, they're doing a wristlet, because they've done that before. But yeah, the hot dog race shirt, I also have a problem. The Orioles are smart with the hot dog race shirt because it's a simple red, yellow, or green shirt that says Orioles and your mustard. Here's the problem. They did it for Monday, May 27th. And that's it. They should have done an entire series where Monday you get ketchup, Tuesday you get relish, Wednesday you get mustard. And made it a 3-T-shirt giveaway and pack out the stadium for 3 nights instead of come and you'll get one of the 3 shirts. And then you just hope your whole family doesn't get ketchup. So that would be...
You got to talk to Josh. He's the idea man.
I would mix that up, because why not make a weekend, a hot dog weekend, and you go Friday, Saturday, Sunday? Because you know I would buy tickets to all 3, and there's many people who would. So I would...
What's the... excuse my ignorance here. And there's not a picture yet because it's not till August. But what's the City Connect rope cap? What's a rope cap? You know what that is?
A rope cap. Oh, is that like a fisherman cap? Rope cap.
I thought it was a cape, because they do capes sometimes.
No, a rope cap is, have you seen like the, I think it's like a fisherman cap or whatever, where it's a baseball cap, but there's a piece of rope where the brim is and the top of the hat. You know what I'm talking about?
No, but I just Googled rope cap, and yeah, I see him. I don't understand. I
didn't
know that was a style of hat.
I think it's like a beach club thing or fisherman or something. It's like a sailor baseball cap. So yeah, I don't know about that.
I've been away from Eastern Shore too long.
What I find really interesting is that last year we saw attendance really go up with the team, which means it's going to continue to go up this year with all the hype and expectations, which means those crowds for the bucket hat, for the shirts, for the bobbleheads, those are going to be some big lines and some big crowds. So it's exciting to see, like, the Santander bobblehead is against the Rays. So that means a big crowd for the Rays. Ketchup mustard shirts, which are going to be popular, is a Monday night with the Red Sox. That's Memorial Day. So that's normally a mid crowd anyway. That's going to be a little bit bigger. So it's cool to see how they've put these, like Mr. Splash bobblehead. That's the Diamondbacks coming to town on a Friday night. That's going to be a small crowd in early May with the Diamondbacks in town. But with that bobblehead is going to bring in 20,000 plus people. So it's going to be cool to see these lower. The Orioles in the past loved to do bobbleheads on like Yankee games and stuff. And the crowds already come for those. So the fact that they're doing it when the Diamondbacks are in town, the A's, the Angels, people who aren't going to bring that big crowd is fun to see. I like that. I think they did a much better job laying out the schedule this year as well.
You didn't get to the spring training giveaways. Because seniors stroll the bases on the March 4th.
Well, spring training
all fans
promotions.
60 years and older can run around the bases.
Well, and when they give stuff away at spring training, it is mostly leftover stuff from the year before.
For instance, is not a thing that you can grasp with your hands. It's an experience that's going to last a lifetime. So I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, look at March 17th as the Orioles give away an Orioles rally towel. That's the same one we get printed for the playoffs.
Yeah. Or, and March 22nd, I have that Orioles cap.
Yes.
I have that.
Yes, they gave that away a couple years ago. So that's always the fun thing about the Orioles spring schedule. Now, like March 8th, which is an Oriole game I'm going to go to, it is an Adley Rutschman spring training T-shirt. So that is a new shirt.
Because you didn't have any Orioles T-shirt, so that's perfect for you.
Exactly. Yeah, but that's all right. It's spring training. I'm not there to get the giveaways. I'm there to see Jackson Holliday.
Okay, since you won't be able to see him the regular season.
Whatever, I'm going to go up and see him for opening day in Baltimore, too. I got to book that flight as well.
Yeah, I haven't even thought about that yet. I got to figure that schedule out.
Stewie Jr. on YouTube was just saying that he did purchase games today, specifically in the Splash Zone.
All right. Well, I don't
because, think regular
Junior is his real name.
Regular tickets went on sale today. And yes, you're probably right. That is not his real name, I would assume.
Yeah. No, but that's cool. I think the Splash Zone is a draw. And it's cool they're bringing it back. I don't know if they're going to bring back all the celebrations, but I think that definitely the bird bath is here to stay.
Like I said, I'm torn.
I also think the wall is going to stay where it is.
Yeah, the wall's staying. Yeah. Though the Hilton might go away. And I want to take, did you see that there was a new owner of the Baltimore Sun?
I saw a lot of people complaining about it.
A lot of people complaining about it.
Yeah.
I got excited for one reason.
Yeah.
Is there any chance this new owner can pay the Orioles to put the Sun sign back up? Because I missed the Sun sign on the Jumbotron.
Oh.
So I know we're talking about doing a new Jumbotron.
I assume this guy has money. I don't know anything about him, but yeah.
He's a local guy. Owns like Fox 45, I think.
Okay.
And Sinclair. So I think he owns 98 Rock as well, or at least used to. So I'd like him to spend the Sun's money. He says he's paid six figures for the Sun. I'd like him to take a little bit more and put the Sun sign back.
Six figures, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
I know. Feel like you could launch your own newspaper, like the Baltimore Banner or something, for cheaper.
No. I thought it'd go more than that.
Oh, really?
But the Baltimore Sun.
I know it's the legacy. It is a legacy paper.
Yeah, I'm surprised. Yeah, six. Well, all right.
So, but anyway, I'm hoping he brings the Sun back, and then I don't care about his politics. Just put the sign back in Camden Yards, and I'm happy. And then, hey, I see the Hilton has lots of problems, so maybe we can tear that down.
Yeah. I also want to mention before we get out of here, Josh, the arbitration. So, just real quick. This past week, you know, the Orioles tried to they tendered a contract to everybody, right? So everyone got a contract. We were debating would Mateo would arise.
Right, everyone.
They tendered a contract to everybody. So then it's just a matter of kind of finding the right number. And they reached contracts with everybody except for Hayes, O'Hearn, Coulomb, Perez, and Webb. The difference is real quick. Hayes won 6.3. I'm surprised we can get all these numbers, which is interesting. O's offered 5.85. O'Hearn wants 3.8. O's offered 3.2. Coulomb wants 2.4. O's offered 2.2. Perez wants 1.4. O's offered 1.1. Webb wants 1 million. O's offered 925,000. Josh, are you pleased that they got all the other deals done? Do any of these undone deals make you feel a certain way? Any thoughts on the arbitration deals that have been done and those that have not been done?
It's great. I don't feel either way. They're all going to get done before the season starts. They're all going to get done before spring training starts. I did talk to one of the agents, and he has no concerns. It'll get knocked out right away and get taken care of. Because it's really, when you're talking $500,000, it's not that $500,000 or whatever. It's not that big a deal.
Well, then why isn't it
done? It'll get done.
Why don't they just say 250 each?
They'll probably end up with 400 or something. I don't know, but it'll get taken care of.
No, it won't. It won't get taken care of, Josh. It's going to end up, what it's going to end up with is him at 5.85.
All right. You're saying
that
the Orioles win whenever it goes longer.
I'm saying all these are not going to get worked out. They're all going to go to arbitration, and the Orioles are going to win all of them.
Okay. Then it is what it is. It's, what's the big deal?
Well, there's some people, Josh. Is it, Twitter, does,
are you thinking then concerns? You think that then people don't want to stay in Baltimore?
Well, and some people say,
well, I can't get the deal done now.
Coulomb was one of your most important bullpen arms, and you're not going to sign him over $200,000. What are you doing? Just give him $200,000 and be done with it. Move on. Some people say that. Why don't they just do it and move on?
Yeah, I don't know. I try not to focus too much on the money side like that, because it is pennies compared to what other teams are spending.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, if
like
you think about
arbitration numbers is the loose change inside of Otani's couch.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, though, if you add up all the numbers this year, the Orioles are fighting over about $3 million, a little less than $3 million if you add up all these numbers.
Right. That's one ball player.
Well, not even.
Yeah.
But if you take this over 10 years, you have these similar arguments over 10 years, that's $30 million.
Right.
That's all of a sudden is a year of Jackson Holliday. So I assume they're going to save all these nickels and dimes, and they're putting them on a piggy bank that says Jackson Holliday on it. And once they get enough, they're going to give it to Jackson.
So it's the,
here you go. So really,
the Austin breaking Hayes, pace of emergency.
Yeah. So Austin or, Hayes is doing this a more, favor by not reaching a deal. So we can save a little bit of money and give it to Jackson later.
Got it. It's not the emergency fund. It's the vacation fund. It's the family puts all their pennies in and say, hey, one day that's going to take us to Disney World. Well, for us, one day it's going to sign Gunnar or Adley or Jackson long term. Well,
one of them. And we got another solution for the other one. That's going to sign Jackson. And you know how we're going to sign Gunnar?
How?
Two words. Sleeve patches.
Oh, well, that was the unofficial announcement this week, is that we worked out a deal with the sleeve patches.
It was about a Gunnar Henderson. It was about a Gunnar Henderson. Yeah, it was like one Gunnar Henderson a year. Like each year of that contract is the year of Gunnar. So we do a 10 years of the patches.
Yeah, they said five years, $75 million for a T. Rowe Price uniform patch.
Yeah, so let's call it 10 years. Let's renew it right now.
All right.
10 years, 150, and just give that to Gunnar.
All right. So it's I like it.
Bump it to 200. 10 years, 200, and we'll give it to Gunnar.
I wish that T. Rowe Price could like make that restriction. Like, yeah, we're going to sign this patch, but this money goes specifically to extending Gunnar Henderson. This isn't
If you don't give it to Gunnar, you don't get it at all.
Yeah. Exactly. It's like, you know, when you've wanted some people that like to donate to like colleges, but they're like, that money means my name's on this building.
Right. You earmark it to certain
same
funds.
Thing. Yeah. Same thing. Yeah. I'm going to earmark it to the Gunnar Henderson, the Keep Gunnar Henderson. Yeah.
I wish we could do that when we went to the team store. We buy our items team store and they give you a little kind of checkbox item.
Yeah.
Where do you want the profits from this money to go to? Into, you know, Peter Angelos's coffers.
Right.
Into John Angelos's lawyer bills. And you have a whole list of things. Into finding Brady Anderson.
Well,
you have a whole list of things and you pick where you want the money to go.
They should let season ticket holders do that. Where it's like, which of these six players do you think the Orioles should extend? And we all get to vote. And you get a one vote for every dollar you spend.
Yeah, there you go. I'd be more likely to buy tickets if some of my money was going to this guy.
Yeah, and it doesn't mean the money goes to that guy, but it kind of tells the Orioles what the season ticket holders feel.
Oh, no, it's got to mean it goes to that guy. What do you mean it doesn't go to that guy?
I'm just saying.
Selecting goes to that guy. It goes to that guy.
Clearly, they gotta make
it. If it doesn't go to that guy, it comes back to me.
No, I'm just saying. A neat way for the fans to kind of say where they're at.
Okay. No, I'm trying. I'm doing more than that. I'm putting my money where their mouth is.
Yeah, but the owner's got to make some money. You know that.
All right, well, hey, sometimes I'll pick Peter Angelos's coffers just to make him feel better. I'll put that sometimes.
All right, gotcha. It'll be like when you donate to like whatever at the grocery store where you can round up. So how about when I go to the team store, it says, would you like to round up to keep Gunnar Henderson in Baltimore?
Yeah, if there was a roundup for Gunnar Henderson fund, I never do the roundup. I'd be honest. I never do the roundup. I always say no.
Right. I'll round up to keep Gunnar Henderson.
I don't round up for Kids for Cancer, but I round up for Gunnar Henderson.
Yeah, I round up for
Gunnar.
You're
sick, Josh. You're sick for saying that.
I hate the roundups.
I do too. Button. I'm a very charitable person.
The
I
only lots thing of charities. Then
no
the roundup
me into giving to a charity. Tell me about your charity. I'm gonna give it to you. Don't try to trick me with the roundup.
Right. The only thing worse than the roundups is the tips. Do you want a tip, even though this is an automated teller and you did everything yourself?
Don't even. I won't even now go to certain establishments that do the tip. I go to coffee shops that don't ask for tips.
I
choose where I go based on that, based on who's asking for tips.
Oh, totally. I had a guy come this week and clean my carpets. You know, we got a new house, so we needed someone to come and steam the carpets every 6 months or so, keep them nice and fresh, nice and new. And he came in and he uses that little square thing for you to pay. And you put your card in and then it pops up on the phone and it's like, do you want to add a tip? And it gives like three options. Before he even handed me the phone, you know what he pressed?
What?
No tip. He didn't even see. He just skipped past the page. Didn't even ask me. I was so proud of that guy. I then talked to him about it, how his Cowboys suck.
He'd probably not give a worker. He's probably the, I would imagine that's a small company. Maybe he's the owner.
No, it's Stanley Steamer.
It's Stanley Steamer. Oh, I thought it was just some local.
No, it's not like Joe I Steam Carpets.
Yeah, I thought maybe it was Joe. And so, of course, Joe wouldn't ask for a tip for his own company.
Okay. No. But I was just happy that the guy just bypassed that altogether. So, speaking of putting your money where your mouth is, yeah, and wanting to choose where to donate your money to, we got two new Patreon members this week.
Oh, look at us. We got rid of the ads.
Yes.
Thank goodness.
I told you guys that we made like $40 off ads or something a month. And I said, you can, we didn't even push Patreon. I said, join our Discord, do whatever. We'll find ways. We know 336ers take care of us, so we'll take care of it. And we got two new Patreon members. So it's a good chance to remind you, you can go join our Discord. Somehow Discord links expire. So just hit me up on Twitter or whatever, or Facebook, if you can't find the link, and I'll send you a new link. But you can also go over to section336.com.
Pin that on our Twitter or something, right?
I did, and then it expires.
Oh, okay.
So I don't know how that works.
All right.
But I like
I shout out to those Patreon members. That's cool. We appreciate you all.
Yeah. So we got two new Patreon members this week, Callie and Len. Thank you guys for joining.
Thanks.
You guys are the real coconuts, the real 336ers, and we appreciate that so much. And then, as well as that, like I said, go over to your Discord. You can find, I'm all over the place. You can join Patreon and sponsor us there by clicking on, I believe it says sponsor at the top at section336.com. I think there's even a link where you can just PayPal us directly. If you don't want to sponsor us, you can just send us cash. Now, I did want to bring up one question to you, Matt, based on one of our new Patreon members who then sent a message over in Discord.
Oh, I must have my Discord loaded or something. I missed that. Okay.
Yeah. So he was saying how the Marlins need guys, and he's wondering if we could possibly, do you see us working with the Marlins, trading Kowser or Kerstead to land Lizardo.
Lizardo. Sure.
Yeah. Or another pitcher. You think there's anything like that?
I heard that they want a starting shortstop and catcher. I don't know if that's we can give him a starting shortstop. Hey, Joey Ortiz, Jordan Westberg.
What about that catcher that we've got? That's like
Sam Basalo.
Yeah,
yeah, or Basayo. No, he's too good.
I really don't want the Orioles to trade him. I really see, like, by the time he'll be ready, he can learn behind Adley for a couple years, and then he might be better than Adley.
Yeah, I haven't watched enough Jesus Lizardo. I know he's young. He's under control for a while. I'll be honest, Josh. I have become convinced. I am convinced that Dylan Cease. I don't even listen to Baseball Tonight, but they had some dude on there, a recurring guest. I forget who they have on there. But talking and comparing Dylan Cease, you know who's compared to at this point in his career? Who? Compared him to Garrett Cole and Max Scherzer. That's who we compared Dylan Cease to.
Really?
That's the comparison he made. This is a young pitcher who still has the electric stuff, who's still working to hone it, and with the right coaching and the right system, which, Josh, by the way, we have the best pitching, coaching, and development.
We did announce pitching staff officially this week as well.
That's fine. Don't get me sidetracked here.
Yep.
I've become convinced that we need to go out and get Dylan Cease. I know the price is probably too high for a guy who had an ERA of 4.5 last year. I get it.
Do you think they're going to try to hold him until trade deadline?
If they do, they're idiots. They're idiots. But I can't blame them, because we were idiots with Manny Machado. We've been idiots time and time again. But if they hold him, when I'm sure the Orioles have a good deal to offer them, then they're idiots. I do know we can offer better packaging than anybody else. I do know we should be able to get Dylan Cease without Basayo, without obviously Jackson Holliday, even without Kerstedt. I think we should be able to, even without Kobe Mayo, depending on who you like more, Kowser or Mayo. I think we can still should be able to get him without giving up your top three prospects, whoever that is in your mind. So I think we should go out and get him. And I think the White Sox should do the deal, because it'd be better for them, because we can get the White Sox three or four really good prospects that are major league ready right now, And I don't, if I'm the White Sox, I'm pulling the trigger now. If I'm the Orioles, I'm pulling the trigger now. But I'm curious to see. I'm curious to see what happens. But I really am. I'm all aboard the Dylan Cease train. I want to see that trade happen.
I hope. I would like it. I don't have much hope for it, but I'm hopeful. I would love to see it. Matt, we always tell people to go on over to iTunes and write us a review or the podcast app, whatever it is. I do not have a new podcast review for you.
Okay.
But
hashtag sad.
But we did get an email.
Oh, an email.
I thought I'd share an email.
I didn't even know we had an email address. Okay.
We do. And Simon sent us an email, and you can do that. There's a contact form on section336.com where you can send us an email through, and that's what Simon did.
Right,
Simon cool. is from North Yorkshire. Do you know where that is?
I assume somewhere in the UK.
It is. It's England.
Yeah.
Hi. Firstly, love the podcast. I thought you might be interested to hear that there's a European Orioles fans WhatsApp group who are a passionate group of fans, as you can imagine. We talk O's and baseball every single day, but due to time zones, we have a curfew where we don't discuss games until noon the next day and give everyone a chance to catch up.
That's good.
In the morning, if a game starts after 10 p.m. UK time, the group is a mixture of British and French O's fans, includes some expats who now live in Europe. If you could give the Mats, Mikes, Enzos, Elliots, and all the European WhatsApp O's a shout out, we'd appreciate it. I also wonder what your thoughts are on the O's and other teams not catering very well to non-US fans. For example, there isn't even a remote club membership option. Cheers. Keep up the good podding, Simon. Now, I love that email because it's someone from... I love the fact that our little podcast, that it goes all the way over the seas and people over in England and French people are listening to it. I love that. I love when
I can
look and see all the different countries that Section 336 goes to.
Je déteste la pêche. Okay, just a little shout out to my French people. All right,
cool. Yeah. All right, sure. So I'll talk to the English people because I can speak English.
Okay.
But I would like all of them to come join us on Discord because I love our conversations there.
But we don't have the curfews.
Yeah, but I'll tell you what, curfews. I don't know. I've watched Oriole games from Zambia, and I don't think I watched any. Maybe I watched one from England. So I understand that time difference, everything. But yes, the Orioles don't do a great job with a family for outside of local Birdland in Baltimore. It would be cool if they had like official club memberships or something for people out of state, out of country. I don't know how you do that. I don't know if it's something that like European soccer clubs do a little better. I'm not familiar. But there's something about taking that fanhood. I think Major League Baseball as a whole is really starting to grow internationally. And I think Otani's a sign of that. But yeah, it would be cool if the Orioles did something to like be like Birdland is everywhere. Like, for instance, I have this idea for Birdland Sports where I was going to make a rip off of those shirts that have like the state and then it says home, but it would say Birdland. Because for me, Birdland is Florida. For you, Birdland's in Georgia. Birdland extends all the way down here. So I think it would be cool, and maybe it's a Birdland sport place to hold it, where some type of Birdland UK representation would be cool for all the countries.
Yeah, I mean, my son was crying the other day talking about discriminating against certain fan bases, that he felt like this started because of a basketball game at Mercer, and I said we couldn't go because the game didn't start till 7. They start crying, saying that like sports hates kids because all this stuff starts at 7 or later, and they don't want kids to watch sports at all. And he would always get upset at baseball when the games went too late. So yeah, but now I told him, and this is what she cheered him up when he was upset. I said all the Orioles home games 6:30, son.
Yes.
So
love it.
Still can't stay up the whole game, but right. We're gonna make it to the fifth inning. So let's
still
go.
Doesn't help the UK that much because that's still like a 9 o'clock something start.
Yeah.
But it's
all right, but no, cool. We appreciate that email.
Thanks for the email.
It's good stuff.
Yeah, make sure. Yeah, share Section 336 over in that WhatsApp group.
Yeah. All right, cool. And we could use a review. So go to iTunes and or Apple Podcasts and give us a review.
Now's the time. We're about a month, just under a month from spring training, pitchers and catchers reporting.
Yep. You can follow us on X. You can follow me at Section 336. You can follow the show at Section 336 Show. And you can follow Josh on X.
At Josh Soroka and at Birdland Sports. And check out birdlandsports.com. There's some new shirts up.
Thanks for listening, boys and girls. And as always, go O's. Go Ravens.